Hey, everyone.
When Brett and Cameron Hudson were born, not even their parents could tell them apart. Raising their identical twins in Charlotte, North Carolina, Byron and Maria Hudson tried to give the boys a charmed life. Brett and Cameron were inseparable. They even invented their own language.
They had their own little twin language, and we couldn't understand them at all.
Every day was joyful. The twins were a constant delight, healthy and happy. Maria and Byron couldn't possibly imagine that overnight their happiness would end.
Life changed for the Hudson family when two-year-old Brett was examined by a doctor on April 9, 1986, after a rash appeared on his body. When the doctor ordered a bone marrow test, Maria and Byron's lives fell apart.
My father had died of leukemia, and I immediately began to just be a little bit afraid that something might be happening.
Brett had the bone marrow test. The doctor had bad news.
And the doctor came in and said, we need to take you into the hospital immediately. Brett needs to go in immediately. He has leukemia.
More bad news when the Hudsons were told that Brett had a rare form of leukemia.
They told us that Brett had a 20% chance to live. We were incredibly devastated.
Treatment started immediately, a course of chemotherapy in Knoll Clinic in Charlotte.
I'd cry, and I was so mad at God if he could take my little baby, who was 2 years old and had never done anything wrong. I didn't think it was fair.
Byron quickly started poring over every article about leukemia, hoping to find some alternative, a key to open the door that was closing on his son's life.
We were grasping for information and did not know anything.
Local doctors told them there was one chance for Brett, a bone marrow transplant. At the time, in 1986, this procedure was just out of the experimental stage and fraught with risks. And at that time, the local hospital could not help them. So Byron looked for the best medical team. With some renewed hope, the family came to University of Minnesota Hospital in Minneapolis. This would be home for the next 2.5 months. It was not a happy place.
There's a little girl on the left side of us. She died. And then a little boy that had just finished his treatment on the right side, he died too. So we were seeing death all around us and constantly looking at those odds which were so terribly stacked against us.
A medical team was assigned to Brett's bone marrow transplant, including Dr. William Crivett and Dr. Norma Ramsey. While there was a glimmer of hope, doctors hadn't handled a case like this before.
We were told that there had not been a transplant done on twins at this age for this type of leukemia.
Then more grim news surfaced. The doctors warned Maria and Byron that Cameron was in danger too.
The genes were identical, and therefore there was the worry that both of them were susceptible to leukemia, and that both of them were going to get leukemia.
Even with doctors warning them that Cameron's bone marrow might not help Brett, Byron and Maria insisted on the procedure. They felt it was right, and that Brett would be saved.
They wanted it their way, and they did not really want to hear our ideas, questions, suggestions, comments.
Then the Hudsons fought the medical team again, demanding multiple doses of radiation. This went against usual hospital procedure.
We felt like that the survival of our child was worth much more than any type of difficult hospital procedures or schedules.
During the bone marrow transplant, the boys were together, but next to his identical twin, Maria and Byron could see how sick Brett was.
When I picked him up clumps of hair would fall onto the pillow. It would break my heart, it would break my soul. Cameron was Brett to me, because he was healthy. He had all the hair that Brett had had. He looked just like Brett was supposed to look. And that's when I realized how bad Brett really was.
And it was only small comfort to know that in some way their plight was helping others.
We kept hearing over and over again that watching what you guys are going through has really made us love our children more.
Mm-hmm.
Because we realized that, you know, we don't have this to go through.
After the transplant, there was yet another hurdle to overcome. Brett had to remain isolated in a bubble crib away from his twin. Brett's condition worsened. The Hudsons pleaded with the hospital to allow Cameron to visit Brett.
I thought, well, he's not going to make it. It's not going to matter if Cameron comes in and brings one germ. It's not going to matter. He's not going to make it.
Against hospital procedure and doctor's advice, they snuck Cameron into the hospital and into Brett's isolated room.
He walked into the room and immediately saw Brett laying up in the bubble crib. And he took a chair and scooted it over all by himself. Nobody told him what to do, and climbed up on it and beat on the crib. And Brett got up, sat up, had not done this at all, and crawled over to the crib to where Cameron was. And they stared at each other and started crying.
Do you think Cameron saved Brett's life in more ways than just giving him bone marrow?
I think Brett would have died if Cameron had not been able to come into that hospital room.
And it may have also been a result of Maria and Byron's insistence on some fairly unorthodox medical procedures that led to a miracle recovery. Weeks later, when Brett was able to leave the hospital, his brother was at his side, just the way they wanted it to be. Even bedtime was fun, as long as they were together again.
Amen.
Over the next few years, Brett's health steadily improved. By the time the boys were six, there was a lot to sing about.
Oh, 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 right stuff.
And if any kids are made of the right stuff, it's the Hudson twins. Today, the boys are nine, and Brett's pediatrician says he looks great.
I give him a clean bill of health.
I'm just so grateful to have a nine-year-old. I never thought that I'd have a nine-year-old.
Brett understands how close to death he came, but it's easier to express himself using his favorite sport.
Let's say you're playing a baseball game, and you're up to bat, and you struck out, okay, and you're on the field, and you're thinking about that strikeout. Well, you should forget about the bad moments, because they'll affect your life a lot.
Do you think you got a home run?
He thinks he got a grand slam.
These two little boys had to learn some hard lessons about life at a very young age. And what they learned is that one of the best things in life is knowing that you have a tomorrow and that you'll be together.
He showed up! He's gonna show up! He's gonna do more than you can ask, think, or imagine! He's gonna do things beyond your comprehension! Let his sword rip through you! Let his sword rip through you! He has to crucify your flesh and crucify your want to, so that his want to can come in your life and his will can come into your life and everywhere you go, so you can be led by the Spirit. You can be guided by your Spirit, but by the Spirit of God.
Baptized me, it was like
power of the Holy Spirit was so strong in the water.
Whenever I went under the water, it was like there was just like this covering of the Spirit.
It was like a power.
It was just like this covering just went over your head. Yeah. It was like
when Cameron baptized me, it's like the power of the Holy Spirit just came in the water and just like completely just saturated.
Yeah.
Just completely saturated me.
You know? Yeah. Immersed in the power of the God. It was so awesome. Uh-huh.
Benny Hinn is this like very famous televangelist who, like, most likely if you've seen impressions of televangelists, like they're based off of Benny Hinn. He's like very famous. Does the like massive events where it's like he's got like the like hair and he's like slaps people on
the white suit, and, like, you know,
white
suit like,
all the way down.
Okay. So we used to go to his like I was in his daughter's class.
When
I was in grade school.
Benny Hinn?
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah.
Your story never ceases to amaze.
No,
this one will blow your mind.
Okay, but so like every year they have like this Halloween type thing. Okay. And me and Cameron decided to go as Benny Hinn and his bodyguard. So I had a lot of hair back then, so I did the whole wave of sprayed my hair gray, you know, and the white suit and you know, everything. And so what I was doing is just going around, I had this whole little routine set up, like, knock them down, take them off, knock them down. I want to be the only one who's getting killed right now.
Dang.
My
that's 250 at least.
My good.
Three times a charm. Look at that blue flag again. Deep.
Brad,
good job, man.
Awesome, man.
Yeah, that is awesome. You're the man. Oh, man. Oh, man.
That was four.
Yeah, this would be for five. All right, here you go, man. You got that putter out.
Get that putter, man.
Here you go. Here's that putter.
He's drenched. Dropping that sand with him.
Get in the hole! Get in the hole! Get in the hole! Get in the hole! Finished with the seven. Brett, you finished with the 101. You finished with the 101 today.
101.
101. All right, let's get to the emergency room. Good job, Brett. Wow.
These guys are totally, like, wasting time. Like, they sit up there. You know, I don't know what they're doing, but it looks kind of shady right now. Yeah, that guy looks like he's,
Which one, the guy in the blue?
Yeah, that guy.
The guy in the blue on the right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like there's some bets going on.
Yeah, it looks like he's kind of looking for cops or something.
Solid, right down the middle. What do you think about that hit, Brett?
Oh, man.
Is that going to put you in the position that you need to be in?
Yeah, I really didn't like the full swing of it, but hey, man, I'm going to get it back with the second shot.
Okay, definitely. What is it, Brett?
It's two tickets to the the Carolina and Pittsburgh game tomorrow.
No way! No!
Are you serious? Are you freaking serious? Oh my gosh!
Isn't that crazy,
Yeah.